Hey, welcome back to JG3 Reviews, and yes, I do have another pen that I want to share with you. It is the Jinhao 35, and it is an all stainless steel pen with a Lamy style nib. This is the second one of these that I reviewed recently. The other was the 166, except there is a difference. This has a fine or an extra fine, and if you want to know what the stock nibs write like, go look at this review at the writing portion. But this I have swapped with a nib from Bobby, a Bobby recommended Lamy style nib. I wanted this pen to try that particularly, and today I'm going to share with you how that went. And if you don't know who Bobby is or what that's about, I'll explain that. Stick with me. Let's flip the camera and get started. Okay, the style of this pen is minimalist. It's stainless steel construction with that Jinhao name etched into the barrel. No model name is etched in, just the Jinhao brand. And a good, very simple, but very strong, sturdy clip. Nice thin seam here. You know, goes down to just a plain finial at the end of the barrel that is polished, and then the same at the top and that finial. So very minimalist, simple design. In some ways, I guess you might say when I open it up that it looks like a larger jotter. The section reminds me a bit of a Parker jotter, but nothing else on the pen really does. This is just a very simple design. As you can see, the grip is also just a stainless steel grip, has that Lamy style nib. And again, this is a replacement nib. We'll get to that here in just a second, with just a very simple feed. This, you'll notice, has an edge to it, and that's because the plastic liner inside the cap, you can just barely see that. There you go, now it focused. There is a small plastic liner inside there that clicks to that plastic edge on the feed. And it holds very well. It's really quite secure. It also does, I almost forget this sometimes, post very securely, and has just a nice clean look when capped. So let's look at inside. You open this up. Again, it is a metal section, but it is not a slippery metal section. There's not enough of that brushing that I would say it's a brushed section at all, but there is a bit of texturing, enough that it's not slippery, and I like that. You do get an included converter, and I notice that this is a different converter than typically comes from Jinhao, but it is a Jinhao branded converter, and it works just fine. I just notice that it's a different handle and just a little bit different overall. And you will also notice that's because it has a wider opening. This is a 3.4 millimeter converter. So it does not take international standard cartridges. It takes 3.4 millimeter cartridge, which is quite common in Chinese pens. And so that's a little bit different, but all functions just fine. So very, very simple. Now let's look at the nib. So the nib on this pen is not the standard. That would look like, while I've got it here, I might as well show you. That would look like the one on this Jinhao 166. And this is a fine, and then I also tested the extra fine. So you can see that in that video. But this is a good nib. In both the fine and extra fine that I have in the 166, I really did like that nib. So I didn't know that I would like it that much when I bought the 35. I bought the 35 first. And so it's kind of funny that it turned out to have a good nib anyway. But I wanted this medium nib from Bobby. So Bobby is a Chinese pen seller and nib seller. Also has some custom grinds that he has done for his Etsy and eBay stores. And you may be familiar with the Jinhao 51A Bobby nib, which you can buy from him, which is excellent. I'll put a link to that review as well. It's a totally different thing from this. But this is his nib that he recommends for pens like this that have Lamy style swappable nibs. And this is a medium. I bought it in a pack of four. Boy, off the top of my head, I don't recall the price, and it might not matter because it might have changed since then because it was a while back. So I'll put a link below so that you can see what the price is now. But I bought multiple nibs for very, very good value and price. So you can check that out on your own. And I believe at that time they were back to free shipping as well. But none of that really matters all that much if I don't like how the pen writes. So let's flip the camera yet again, and we'll see how this bobby nib on the Jinhao 35 writes. Again, this is a medium, and this is a bobby. And this is a recommended nib, not to be confused with that famous bobby nib, which is for like a Jinhao 51A or a Wing Sung 61 or something like that with a hooded nib. And though this looks darker on camera today, I don't know quite why. This is Noodler's Lexington Gray, which for some reason just looks dark. It's well saturated coming out of this pen. I think that's part of the deal. Now, how does he spell that? How does he spell Lexington? Good, with an A. Sometimes I get forgetful about whether Gray is with an A or an E, because one of those is English and one of those is American English, and I just kind of forget. Test for wetness here. So now that kind of shows you the shading of it actually being gray, because it kind of looks black on camera today with the lighting in here. But there you go. So I think that's pretty good saturation for a medium, or not saturation, pretty good wetness for a medium nib. Now, one of the things that I notice is on this paper, I'm not hearing it. On some papers, and it was a cheaper notebook paper, this nib sings a little. I don't know, you ever had a pen that sings? There are certain brands that are more likely to sing than others, the nibs. This one doesn't look like I crossed that, but I'm pretty sure I did. This one sometimes on certain papers just hits just the right resonance, and it starts to make noise. Not in a bad way, although, you know, that depends on the person, right? So to me, it might not be annoying. To you, it might be. Just kind of a weird little noise, but it's not the only pen to have done that or nib to have done that. I'm going to do a little bit of scribble. You wouldn't be able to read it if I wrote it in scribble anyway, so it might as well be gibberish. As you notice, the pen and feed keep up very well with this medium nib. And that's good, because if you swap a nib out, you know, you're messing with things. And sometimes a pen that flowed well with, say, the extra fine or the fine doesn't when you put a medium on it. No problem here. In fact, I find it did improve the pen. And it wasn't that the other nib was bad. I think it suits this pen very well, this medium nib. All right, so let's sum things up. Do I like this pen? I do. When I first got it, let me share something with you. When I first got it, it was with the purpose of putting this nib on it. So I wasn't really worried about the nib that came on it. And I've mentioned to you that it should write just like this one with the extra fine. But I want to share with you that this one actually needed just a wee bit of tuning. The tines were just a little bit too close together, which, you know, at first glance, you just think it's an extra fine that might make sense, but it needed to be spread just a little bit. So I did a little bit of spreading the tines. In my case, I had some kind of a plastic sheet that had come with another pen, and I was able to run that between the tines and spread them apart. And then it was great. So, you know, that happens every now and then. That can happen with pens costing $500. You'll hear about that a lot in other people's reviews. So that doesn't really bother me. I'm willing to work with that. However, you know, I think you ought to know. I have had zero issues with the Bobby recommended Lamy style nib that I put on it, and it didn't raise the cost of the pen hardly a thing. I think that nib, when you broke it down to per nib, I bought them in a package of several, maybe just over $1 for the nib, just over $1 for the nib, and putting it on a pen that I got for just a few bucks, still very happy, still a great value, and excellent. And it's, so that's why it's good to have, really, some extra nibs that are good quality and reliable, that if you buy something like this, you can put on there at very little cost, swap those things out, and salvage something. That's the thing that's good about, and that's true of a lot of different nibs from a lot of different companies and everything else. If you'll have some spares, or if you buy a pen and the nib is awesome, but the pen is a dud, swap that nib to a pen that you like. If you've got a number six, a couple of people got an italics pen that wasn't writing quite the way they wanted or wasn't writing, well, the nib, don't chunk it. Grab that nib out of that thing and put it in a Jinhao 100. That's what Douglas Rathburn did, and he loves it. So it's good to do that. You can put in a Jinhao X450. I got my X450 for $4.50. Put that italics nib in there. Maybe you would even want to do that. Just order the pen to get the nib. Why not? I've done that. I've ordered pens just to get the nib because the pens were so reasonable. And then sometimes I end up liking the pen anyway, and then there you go. I don't actually end up with an extra nib. But you know how that goes. That's one of the neat things about some of these pens that are so inexpensive, a few bucks, $1.40, and yet write very, very well. So do I like the pen? Yes. That's going to be up to you if you like metal pens. Not everybody likes a metal section. I mean, they're like at religious levels against, you know, throw them in the middle of the volcano because we're done with them kind of feelings about a metal section. Don't buy this pen. You won't like it. It has one. The whole pen is metal. That's the way it is. But if you like stainless steel, like I do, if you like minimalist pens, I like those too, then yeah, I think it's a fun pen. It looks, you may think it looks a lot like a Parker Jotter, but this is a much bigger pen. You'll notice that when you look at this, can I think of the words? Specifications. Wow, I just all of a sudden lost the ability to talk. When you look at the specifications, you will notice that actually this is a much bigger pen than a Jotter. It's not heavy, it's just larger dimensions in pretty much every way. It's not, as far as I can tell, a copy of anything. Although minimalist pens, you probably could find a metal tube out there that looks like another metal tube. That happens. But I do like it. On the nib, the Bobby Lamy style nib, do I recommend it? Yeah, keep those. Keep them for spares. Maybe you've got a fine Lamy Safari and you don't want to pay $15 just for a nib and you don't want to buy another pen. You'd just like to have a medium. Get this. It gives you some spare nibs. Try it out. And then if you really like it, but you'd rather have had the Lamy, but you like the medium on your Safari, well, then guess what? You haven't spent much, and now you still have money to go get the Lamy nib, right? So that's kind of some of the things that I do. That's how you end up with all these extra spare nibs, but that's part of the hobby, and it's part of the fun. You end up, it's the same thing, you know, it's you work on lawnmowers. When I was a kid, I had, you know, I mowed lawns like a lot of guys do in their 10 to 13 years. And so I had spare lawnmower engine lying around, and I put that with a spare lawnmower body lying around. You end up with this great Franken mower. Well, a lot of people like to make Franken pens as well. So some of these things, they enable you to do that. And the nib on this is one of those things. So I think I'm on the verge of rambling. So I'm going to say, God bless you, have a great week, and know when to fold and know when to hold them. I'll see you later. Y'all have a great weekend.